the Central Business Architecture Committee meeting on Tuesday, March 7th, 2017. This is to discuss possible design guideline changes, section 4 to guideline 8 and forward. Is there any public comment? I don't think so. There's no one here from the public, so we start where we left off.
Start off with guideline 8, or
section 4. Let me just, I can pull it up on the screen.
Buildings on corner lots.
I think we might have finished guideline 4.
I think we're up to guideline 8.
Yes.
Yeah, I think that's what the agenda says.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Up to 8?
Yeah, guideline 8 and forward.
The upper floor window ranges?
Where's 5, 6, and 7?
We went through those.
Yeah, no.
So the last thing that we talked about was guideline 7, which was the first floor facades. And the very last thing that we talked about was sign ban in coordination with signage regulations.
Right.
So starting with guideline 8, which is upper floor window arrangements for theme building street facades. And I'll just go through the points one by one and we can comment. Historic window arrangements, including lintels, sills, and masonry surrounds, should be preserved when present. I see no reason to change that. Windows for new theme buildings should be organized so as to create rhythmic, symmetrical patterns. Windows should be aligned vertically and horizontally. Again, I agree with that. On new theme building facades, windows should cover a minimum of 20% and a maximum of 40% of the facade area above the first floor, coverage based on window outer frame size. I think that guideline is also fine. New window header heights should align horizontally with those on at least one adjacent building where feasible. Again, that seems reasonable to me. On new theme building facades, windows should be evenly spaced in the horizontal direction with no more than 1.25 times the window frame width between windows or from windows to building corners. Exceptions may be made if windows are arranged in groups. And there's a diagram that sort of explains that.
I'm just curious, Carolyn, do you know how that was established, as well as like the 20% and 40%? 20% and 40%. Did someone actually take a survey and measure the areas of the buildings and come up with that?
I don't know how it was derived, but these are sort of common themes in terms of design guidelines.
Yeah, I think these were lifted from
historical
guidelines, because I've seen things comparable to this all over the country. So.
Yeah, I mean, that's what I would guess. I mean, there was obviously a survey done of the buildings and sort of, and then obviously the classification of the building type.
Mm-hmm.
But I can't imagine these were created, you know, uniquely.
It's a cut-based operation.
Right. When you're studying historical buildings, they often talk about the rhythm and the pattern and sort of these calculations that you can use to create those patterns. And I'm guessing that that's where they took it.
Yeah, architecture is from the
guidelines.
Yeah.
Okay. New horizontal window groups should form rhythmic, symmetrical patterns on the building. Within groups, there should be a wall space between window frames of not more than one half the window width. Such wall spaces shall be of masonry materials, the same as or compatible with other facade materials. That sentence is a little bit confusing to me. It says, it shall be masonry materials the same as or compatible with other facade materials, which to me would mean it can be masonry, but not necessarily.
So masonry versus stucco, or what are we saying here?
Well, that's what I'm saying, is that it's a little bit confusing. And on the first part of the sentence implies that it shall be a masonry product, But then the second half of the sentence says, or compatible with other facade materials, which would imply that it could be something other than masonry, but the what that other material is not necessarily clear, other than it should be compatible with masonry.
Well, see, I think how interesting all of the advancements they've made in the green building materials with the recycled content and all those things, that really, the engineered products that are, you know, the same type of thing. I think to leave this in there is at least giving room for that.
For optional, for other materials.
Yeah.
So would this be your read that this is for, I mean, it does say new horizontal window group, so I think this is assuming a new theme building, but if that's not clear either, because I would think if you're doing an addition to an existing building, it makes sense where that you you know, that you do use compatible material to the facade of the original.
Mm-hmm.
But it's not clear to me which one, you know, if this is specifically for new or additional.
Well, new horizontal window groups could imply that it would be either a new building or an addition to mm-hmm. an existing building, versus new theme building would only imply just a new building,
yeah,
and leave out an addition, right?
So you think, so then this, then either way would make sense. Let's, for example, if you had an addition that you, the original was masonry, and the addition, to call it out differently, would, could be something that's not masonry, but considered compatible. Is that?
Well, I think it talks a little bit about, we'll get into other materials for the overall building. I think that this is specifically talking about when you have a group of windows together, that the space between the windows shall be masonry or another material.
Yeah.
And then it says wall spaces between or next to the new window groups should be no more than 6 feet wide.
Well, I can give you an example of something, and just of things that we were talking about when we were redoing the building on our office over on King Street. You have where the drive-in used to be on the sides. It just, let's just say that was the actual front of the building, so it would be this example. There used to be the windows there. And so the choice was, so he ultimately decided to just, you know, make it a solid wall. But the reason he didn't do all of that was because there was going to be the need for, you know, different types of insulation, and then there was supposedly going to be something about having to frame them differently to sort of be the same way as the front of the building, all sorts of things. And I think that that's what they're talking about. So if that material that was going to be using to frame in between the three windows that were not the same size windows that were on the front were, if Jonathan Wright then used a different material, mm-hmm. then that's what I think they're speaking of here, I think. Right?
I think so too. So I guess I think what it's trying to say that ideally the material should be masonry between the windows, but there is the option to use something that's compatible, and that it relies on the designer to prove to the committee that the material between the windows is.
Yeah, so I mean, I think we've even approved some projects where, you know, like stove type materials we use
right.
in conjunction with masonry because they're compatible in a sense, you know, visually. You know, so.
But often the color of the material is just as important as what the material is.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so it doesn't sound like there's any need to make a change to this. New windows may be, did I skip one?
No, maybe symmetrically ganged, that's right.
Okay. New windows may be symmetrically ganged without intervening masonry wall spaces if the total width of a set of gang windows is not more than 6 feet. My concern with that is that 6 feet is actually pretty narrow if you think about a group of large windows, like If you look at those windows, those are probably at least 3'6". If you tried to gang them together, that's only two windows, and that's over 7 feet. So to have more than two windows, you'd have to have very narrow windows.
Yeah, 6 feet for sure. Like 6 feet works for two, that's about it.
Right.
So.
Especially as it, because somewhere later on it talks about windows shall be somewhere between 2 and 3 feet wide. So I just want to perhaps.
Yeah, so that could be right.
Does that also make a difference about this, the width of the facade that you're dealing with too?
Right.
Though that could imply that means you can't put three windows together because it would be more than 6 feet.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Right.
And do we?
Yeah, because you would want to emphasize the verticality of the facade, and if you get more than 6 feet, then you become horizontal, unless you're designing a Chicago-style band,
mm-hmm.
which I don't think you would do on any of the older buildings down here. That sense of verticality, to me, is the important thing to keep.
And that's what, with the restriction of 6 feet, you think maintains that?
Yeah, probably.
Because it does talk about window bays later, which is, to me, a window bay would have at least three windows in it. And there's some nice photographs that show some nice bay windows. So maybe that doesn't necessarily limit the grouping of windows to just two.
Would that be considered not a gang or window arrangement if it's a bay?
I guess that's what the guidelines kind of imply, is that gang windows, you know, like the diagram shows, is just two windows together, whereas a bay actually might have a projection and be.
So, do you want to try to change that to imply, like instead of using a specific like 6 feet, say as long as the shape of the space maintains a vertical appearance? Because that's what you're saying, that three gang would start to be too much more horizontal.
Yeah.
I don't know if I have the right words, but
right,
you know what
I'm
trying to get
at. Exactly. If you add an extra window on the side, you can see where you start to get the banding in. It destroys the sense of verticality.
And I mean, these are referring to upper windows of theme buildings. So maybe maybe it should be kept at six, or maybe there's a way to bring it back to the, you want it to be vertically symmetrical with the first floor in some way. I don't know if that makes sense.
So this is a good example of a building that has, you know, three windows, but that's considered a bay. This is under guideline 12. So there's a bay, and then there's a series of single windows.
Technically, I think that's an oriental window. A bay goes all the way down to the ground.
See, now here's, for example,
okay.
This example here.
Finesse.
I mean, it's a minor point, but that's really a three gang situation.
Right.
The separation is like 6 inches or less there.
Right.
So
but you have to still have a sense of verticality in the whole thing. Because it's.
Do you think that's more than 6 feet, those three?
Oh, yeah, definitely.
Oh, yeah.
Not this.
Well, the one right next to it, too. They're both
right.
Yeah, Exactly. The right one, there's the space is a little larger. But they're basically the same block. Might just be that. Maybe that is virtually the same building.
Where is this?
That one?
Yeah, the one on the guideline 12.
What's that? On page 28?
I don't know,
mine isn't.
Oh, he's looking at that one up on the screen.
Oh, okay.
Oh, yeah, that, yeah.
Yeah, that's,
it's the same one.
Yeah, this one. Yeah.
Yeah, that's not,
it's
a different one, is it?
So that, the other one that
that's
Alan was talking about before was on page, or guideline 12.
Yeah.
You're talking about, where's that building?
Yeah, I'm getting a picture because it's Hampshire Realty.
Is that Fitzwillie's, like, or next to
Lucky's? None of these places are there anymore.
Yeah.
Well, that's where the Zen restaurant used to be, where Hampshire Realty is, and now it's another.
Veracruzana?
Yeah.
Veracruzana's,
yeah. Okay. Okay, I've been living here for a long time.
Right at Lucky's, this one.
Got it.
This is where the it's not Zen anymore, the Zen restaurant.
Yeah, I know what you're talking about now.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Yeah, I just was like,
yeah.
I totally lost
it. Yeah. Same family, different name.
Well, I was thinking, wow, when did Quiznos leave? That was a long time ago.
Well, and actually looking at that photograph up there where it has the 313, technically that wouldn't be considered a gang of windows because there's no mullion, there's no material, building material.
A gang implies mold, a gang implies a mold unit.
A mold window unit,
right. You still have very small separations.
Of masonry,
those.
Right.
Yeah, but it's masonry because it has to support the arch up there above.
Yeah.
Okay, well, so.
So, I guess, do we want to change that is not more than 6 feet? Do we want to add anything about, or shall not be, or shall maintain a vertical?
I would say maintain a sense of verticality.
Yeah, I don't think we want a specific. Yeah.
So eliminate six feet?
Or just say new windows may be symmetrically ganged without intervening masonry wall spaces if the total, or do we just from that point forward say as long as the groupings maintain a sense of verticality on the overall facade of the building?
That's better.
As long as the grouping maintains a sense of verticality, is that what you're saying?
Mm-hmm. Overall verticality on the entire facade. If sets of gang windows are evenly spaced on the facade, the distance between them should be no more than 1.25 times the width of an individual window in the gang. Exceptions may be made if gang windows are arranged in groups.
So, if you say an exception can be made, there's really no guideline, right? You're really detracting from what you just said. It's saying we can decide, basically.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, often the language of guidelines gives you something like this. It's it should be encouraged, as opposed to thou shall limit yourself to that. And that gives you a little flexibility when somebody comes in with a really nifty idea.
New ganged windows may be grouped if there are wall spaces between gang groups of not more than 1/2 the width of an individual window in the gang. The distance between window gangs or between a ganged window group and the vertical edge of the facade should be no more than 6 feet. And that's, I think the diagrams explain that pretty clearly.
Little diagrams. Mm-hmm. Very architectural.
New window bays may be used if their design implied in a historically appropriate manner, are arranged symmetrically or centrally on the building, and are not individually wider than 1/3 of the overall facade width. Spacing of window bays should follow the preceding two guidelines for ganged windows.
Not this again
with the courthouse.
Oh, that's right.
Really don't like the courthouse and the guidelines. ready to move on to guideline 9?
Yes.
So guideline 9, upper floor window size and design for theme building street facades. When present, historic window components should be preserved or replicated if replacement is necessary. Such elements include rectangular or arched wood-framed windows, divided light sash, ornamental and structural lintels and sills, and special masonry surrounds. Replacement may be with different materials if visually equivalent. I mean, that's fine. Windows for new buildings should be of a size and design compatible with nearby buildings using clear, not mirrored glass. Again, I'm fine with that.
Yep.
There's a question in the Elm Street Historic District. Not just clear or mirrored, but if it is
tinted,
dark or smoked glass or something like that, that seems to be something that is being used now for environmental
energy reasons.
Mm-hmm. So I wonder if clear would include that.
Well, clear, I guess, means that you have the ability. In here, mm-hmm. it means that you can see through it, and that it's not, it doesn't have a reflective surface on it.
Right. So a beer bottle is clear in that definition,
yeah.
instead of brown.
Right. Mm-hmm.
But the energy efficiency stuff that they're doing on historic buildings typically is just like a mm-hmm. like a film that they put on your
right.
car, like a tinting
yeah.
of your car. So, I mean that. I think especially Bob, you know, better than anyone. I mean, the cost for any sort of construction here in Northampton or Amherst area is so much higher than any other town to mandate. Anything, you know, to keep it at such a strong, high standard with windows, like, and not let people do something that might, you know, help them with their energy needs. I think it'd be, you know, it would open up a Pandora's box.
Well, and I think too that you have to, the energy codes are getting stricter and stricter, and so in some ways, in order to meet the requirements of the energy code, you have to use high efficiency glazing
right.
in your windows. So I don't think we can dictate that, but high
yeah.
efficiency glazing,
as long as you can see through it, as
right,
opposed to
doesn't need
yeah,
to be.
Yeah, they don't want Barney sunglasses looking up
right.
Right.
back
yeah.
at you.
Because you know, when these buildings were first built, probably 90% of them had awnings,
mm-hmm.
and that was just very commonly done on all these windows,
yeah.
right.
and that was for exactly that purpose,
yeah.
right.
to keep the sun on.
Yeah.
Actually, the energy codes are they applying to commercial yet, or are they going to be this year?
The new energy code just came out in January. I'm not quite familiar with
yeah.
upgrades to glazing, but
before that, I mean, commercial buildings are pretty much exempt from energy codes, I believe. No?
No.
Mm-hmm.
It's not, ironically, it's not quite as strict as residential buildings.
Okay.
But
yeah, that was it. Yeah.
You still, anything over 5,000 square feet, there's a commercial energy code requirement.
But getting back to this, we could just say using clear, not mirrored, colored, or smoked glass.
But are you saying though that the smoked glass might be, if it's, it could still be clear, but smoked for energy purposes,
right, and it's
right?
not necessarily smoked, but it is going to have a tint to it.
Mm-hmm.
The glass will be
tinted.
Yeah,
well, like the coatings that they use,
right.
which a lot of times, well.
Or just say, you know, saying it like this, not mirrored, smoked, or whatever the last term you
said, colored.
Except for the instance where an energy efficient film is added.
Yeah, except where prohibited by the energy code.
Right.
Yeah,
you're right, something like that.
A film is a reversible change.
Right,
you
exactly.
Without a coating, you can still get a very energy efficient window. You know,
without what?
Without a coating. You can still get a very energy efficient window,
yeah.
triple glazed or whatever,
mm-hmm.
necessary.
Mm-hmm.
So I mean, I think, you know, an architect or designer could work around that, get away from that, if we implied that we didn't want a fill.
Well, I think that the mostly what we don't want is mirrored glazing.
Yeah.
So using clear, not mirrored glazing.
And colored, so if you say color, so what if somebody comes to us with like
a very dark brown?
I'm thinking like something with a, you know, it's a center window, you know, it's three windows and the center has a really beautiful stained glass of four different colors. I mean, granted, these are guidelines. If it looks really beautiful, we could still approve it, but no.
But that could still be clear, the color, right? You could have a blue glass or a red glass that you could, wouldn't you say?
That you can still see through it.
Yeah. So I think staying away from color is probably safer.
Yeah.
And just keeping it as is, knowing that, you know, there may be some
Mirror or reflective. The reflective part is where, I think it, when it's going to blind somebody across the street.
Right.
Driving by, you can see your face in it.
Yeah,
check your lipstick.
Well, you know, that's interesting, actually. I think, if I remember this correctly, maybe you guys remember, on the building next to the police station, not the Masonic Lodge, but the old, you know, where I'm talking about, right?
The big yellow building with the pillars.
Yeah.
The Elks building.
Yeah.
I think the glass they put in there has some kind of reflectivity. Because I think there's a certain angle. I think some people have complained about the reflect. You wouldn't necessarily know it.
Those big windows between the columns in the front?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I don't know if adding reflectivity in here will even tighten that a little bit.
Just say not mirrored or reflective.
Yeah. Because I think you're right that that's the issue. It's not whether it has a little bit of tinting for energy purposes, but I think people have complained a little bit that there's certain times of day when you come out and it's just sort of glaring along that.
Or if they have an apartment up in across the road from whatever building it is, and it's a certain time of day, it's just like
So
and also, the darker the tint, the more reflective it's going to be.
Okay. Yeah, I kind of feel that we should put like dark tinted in there too. We don't want dark windows.
I guess that's subjective though, right?
Yeah, what is dark?
I mean, if it's framed out and it's being darkened because that room is actually, now being used as a bathroom or something, you know, and that's the reason they didn't want to put glass block there or something, you know.
That's what shades are for.
But you could also put a frosted finish on it, which wouldn't be reflective necessarily.
Yeah. The other thing is, this is going to come before you guys. So if there was a really dark glass,
right,
you could say this is inconsistent with the character or something like that. I would guess you'd be able to hang here.
It says using clear, we could bring up the point that
I can't see through your window.
Clear,
I want to see what you're doing in there.
I mean, maybe we're getting too fussy, but I don't know. It's just.
Well, so maybe it says using clear glass, mirrored or reflective or significantly dark glazing.
Well, that's what I was trying to say, like dark tinted. Yeah,
right. If you said significantly dark, then that implies that you don't want it black or really dark brown.
Right,
like what are they doing behind there?
is that acceptable to add that?
So using clear
glass.
Parentheses, not mirrored.
Reflective or significantly dark.
Tinted or dark. Dark tinted.
Okay. Typical new windows should be vertically oriented rectangles or arch tops with a frame height to width ratio between 1.67 and 3.0, or as an example, a 5-3 or a 9-3 ratio. There should be some traditionally appropriate horizontal divisions within the frame, but not snap and grills. Divisions should be equal or nearly equal in size. Ratios, shapes, orientations, and divisions may differ for small windows below the cornice or storefront facades and in some other special locations. I think that in general that's it's a fine guideline and it's loose enough to be able to have some wiggle room but also give some definition. So I don't actually have any issues with that.
So in other words, an appropriate horizontal division within the frame, like a meeting rail.
Mm-hmm.
But in other words, you can't have a fixed clear unit.
And if you did have a fixed window, you'd still want to have like a simulated divided line or something.
Yeah,
well, that's like the courthouse is.
But
inappropriate.
Right.
But what's the issue with snapping grills? Because if you had that double hung window, one over one, and you put snapping grills on the inside, what's wrong with that?
You can't see it from the outside, and so you don't.
Right, but if it wasn't there, it would be no different than seeing one over one, which is okay.
You wouldn't have a shadow line on the exterior. It would just be.
Right, but you're allowing that to be fine, a one over one. There's no shadow lines there.
Uh-huh.
It adds character to the inside of your apartment. That's why you put those grills in. Mm-hmm. But it doesn't really affect, it makes it no worse to have a snap-in grill on the inside versus just having a one over one. You're still looking at a divided.
Well, so you would see a snap-in grill when you're looking from the outside through the windows, and we don't typically have in the downtown district anything other than a one over one or a two over two. It's very rare to have like a 12 over 12 or a six over one.
This whole thing with Robin Friedenfeld with the building over there on the Sonic Street.
Yeah.
It's that, I don't know what it's called now, I swear. It was the old Smith class next to the Paul Room, that long row building.
Yeah.
It's all condos.
Mm-hmm.
So they're going through loops and bounds there because a lot of people don't want to pay for a simulated divided light window because they have six over sixes in the existing building.
Mm-hmm.
So, they're.
This is Smith Glass, like way down on
Connor. No,
it's an old mill building, so it's not a themed commercial building.
Oh,
right next to Packard's is the alleyway,
and then that building on the other side of the alley is
a long old mill building.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
It's all condos now.
Okay, so you found the one building that has six over six.
There's more.
Okay,
but I think there is a difference because you're creating the false sense that they're divided windows and you can tell they're not, so either they are or they aren't. I mean, I think, or you create.
But we should also include grills between the glass then in this line. Because
it's
the same thing, they're inside, you don't see them as a shadow, a grill between the glass. Frankly, I think they look worse than popping grills between the glass. They're always flat, they have no dimension to them.
So you're saying.
But a simulated one has that shadow line in between and then one on the interior and one on the exterior.
I mean, that's the best for sure. Yeah.
And
they're expensive windows, and that's what people's complaint is.
Well,
I have 2 points I'm discussing here.
Yeah.
I mean, the other thing is, if we're going to imply no snapping grills, we should also say no grills between the glass.
Right. That makes sense.
Because,
not snapping grills or grill between the glass, should we say simulated divided lights are acceptable?
I think so.
You would have a three-dimensional component on the exterior of the glass.
That's what a simulated divided light is, it has a component inside, the outside, and between the glass.
So it does create a shadow.
Right, it creates a shadow.
That's the most important thing. Because with these buildings historically, you're going to get the 1/1 or the 2/2.
Yeah.
You're not going to get the this 6/6. That would be, unless it's a colonial revival style. Mm-hmm. And you've got a couple of those around here, but it's not like we're in Williamsburg or something like that.
Yeah.
Here it's just good old 19th century commercial.
So is that clear, Carolyn?
Yes. Does that make sense? Simulated divisions are allowed?
I would call it a simulated divided light.
Okay.
Because that is a window term.
Okay.
So simulated divided lights are acceptable, however, snap in grills or grills between the glass are not acceptable.
Do we have anything in the language that would preclude a jalousy window? And people even use those anymore.
I don't think you can even use those anymore. They're not energy. It's zero energy efficiency.
Yeah.
Right?
Like the metal windows?
No, it would be horizontal, and you crank them, and each panel sort of opens up.
I don't think that would be.
Like Venetian blinds almost, but glass.
Yeah, I don't think it's relevant. No one's going to want to put those in.
Like they had a seasonal porches?
Certainly not on a theme building. Which is this is specifically for theme buildings.
Do you want to read that back just the way we said that? Just for
So typical new windows should be vertically oriented rectangles or arch tops with a frame height to width ratio between 1.67 and 3.0. There should be some traditionally appropriate horizontal division within the frame, but not snap-in grills or grills between the glass. A simulated divided light, simulated divided lights are acceptable.
Okay. So moving on to the next one. The width outside frame of new window openings should be between 2 feet and 3 feet. So this again seemed a little bit limiting to me because these are big buildings with big windows. Like that could be bigger than 3 feet.
Absolutely.
So I was wondering if we could say between 2 feet and 4 feet. I don't imagine any of the windows are larger than that. And we've already talked about the ratio. So if it's that wide,
it's
going to
get too big and
taller.
Scale,
right.
I'd be okay with
Upping that up. New windows should have visible, historically compatible masonry sills and lintels or masonry arch tops. Sills or lintels may consist of decorative brick accents in brick facades with vertical orientation or color. Again, that's perfectly fine.
Yeah. Nobody on these buildings, they don't use pressed metal on any of that stuff historically. Like on some of the cornices.
No, there's a lot of, there's still some metal cornices. And
yeah,
stuff
but
up in
no, town. No window arches. Okay. I don't recall seeing any downtown.
Yeah, it's what was the flower shop that's the flower shop right across from the Academy of Music?
LaSalle.
Right? Do you remember when they had the big fire there?
Yeah.
I was down there that morning with Reckman, and we knew that Bill Latender, he was involved in it. I'm walking around the fire scene, I'm starting to find all these little metal-like triangles about this big all over the ground. I started figuring out they were really cool. They were like galvanized metal. They were like dentils that were on the facade, and from the heat of the fire, the solder melted, and they all dropped to the ground.
Oh, wow.
I picked up a few of them. Pretty cool.
Hopefully the whole block didn't burn down.
Yeah,
I know.
Yeah, that was the one. Yeah, so there are definitely, at least I know metal cornices around.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
But they're painted and they tend to look like wood, you know, so you don't really can tell.
So the last item in this section is new window openings on a given floor should be no taller or wider than those on the floor below, which makes sense. You want them to diminish as they go up, if they do diminish.
Right.
so they don't get top heavy. Guideline 7-10, should we do the, should this be our last one?
Sounds good to me.
Okay. Guideline 10, facade materials. Historic building materials should be preserved when present. Such materials include wood, stone, brick, cast stone, cast iron, and pressed metal. I think that that's fine. For theme and landmark buildings, wall surfaces which are visible from streets should be predominantly brick and or traditional varieties of stone. Ornamental metal detailing may be used if historically appropriate. Facsimile materials which replicate an appropriate historic appearance of brick, stone, or metal are also acceptable. Stucco is an acceptable surface for walls not fronting on a street. I don't like stucco, but I guess I'm okay with that.
But what is that saying? Is you can't have stucco on a front facade?
I would say unless it's historically there, then you should be able to replicate it. But you shouldn't introduce it.
On the front facade.
Right.
So those two buildings that Seth Jolly did.
They're all stucco.
They're all stucco.
Yeah. But they're not on
a street.
Right.
They're not fronting on the street. For transitional, is everybody okay with that?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, for transitional residential construction on side streets, traditional wood clapboard siding and wood trim should be used. So, I you know, there's lots of new materials out there that are sustainable and easier to maintain than wood. Composite materials.
Yeah, we've been allowing it anyway.
Yeah.
It reads that way.
I'm just wondering if we should say, you know, traditional wood clapboard siding and wood trim should be used. Alternative sustainable material, clapboard materials may also be.
As long as you're not talking about aluminum or
vinyl
siding.
Mm-hmm. Well, there is something in here that says vinyl siding is inappropriate.
Hardy plank has become very acceptable in preservation.
Well, fortunately,
I
was just going to say, like the Hardy, like
whatever the
Hardy siding, like you know, clapboard siding. Mm-hmm. They've actually improved the profiles on it too.
Oh, yeah.
So it used to be just flat planks, like you know, a square, and now they're starting to put the little back cut on them. Like
yeah, you can't really even tell that it's not.
You want to avoid the texture.
A smooth finish.
Yeah, the textured ones just don't capture anything.
Wood.
Okay, traditional wood clapboard siding and wood trim,
or sustainable engineered products should be used.
Excellent.
That's the phrase. Write that down.
These buildings may incorporate other building materials which are historically compatible with wood clapboard. I think that's fine. Mm-hmm. Vinyl siding is inappropriate. Again, I think that's fine.
You have to say vinyl or aluminum.
People still use aluminum.
I haven't seen it in my.
You can get it, but it's pretty.
When siding is applied, it should leave all existing trim and structural features such as brackets, corner boards, hoods, etc., undisturbed and visible. That's fine. Mortar joints for new masonry construction should be no more than 3/8 inch thick for brick or 1/2 inch thick for other masonry elements if they are at least 8 inches high and 16 inches wide. Mortar color should not significantly contrast with the masonry in hue or darkness. Fine with that.
Before we go on, can I just go back to this vinyl siding?
Mm-hmm.
It says vinyl siding is inappropriate. Is the next sentence meaning, but when siding is applied, it should leave all existing trim and structural features such as brackets, corner, blah, blah, blah. If that's the case, do we want that or we just say vinyl siding? No.
Well, doesn't that imply when you're putting new siding up?
I think what they're saying is that all the details of the building that are not the base siding should be maintained. So if there are brackets at the roof or there's some trim elements, you know, as long as they can be maintained.
So any kind of siding.
This is just a grammatical progression that you don't know what the siding is referring back to.
So can you, should we say vinyl siding is not allowed?
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Is there any reference in here to width of siding to make sure that it's comparable to the original? Because often they'll put something that's too wide.
Yeah, I know.
Not appropriate. Again,
could you say, I guess that first sentence, it says, for transitional residential construction on side streets, traditional clapboard siding of...
traditionally sized?
Appropriate dimensions or historically correct dimensions.
comparable to the original that's on the building.
Comparable to the original.
So if on the building it's 8 inches, then you go with 8 inches, but if it's 4, go with 4.
Okay, traditional clapboard siding.
Should be compatible with existing or original siding.
So I guess what you could say is clapboard exposure should replicate the existing clapboard exposure.
Right.
And trim.
And trim.
Yeah.
In dimension.
Shall, what did you say, be consistent or shall?
Shall replicate.
Actually readable up there.
Okay, so such clapboard and trim exposure shall replicate
the original.
Dimension.
Width.
Such clapboard and trim exposure shall replicate the original dimension of the exposure.
Exposure.
Or you could say, shall replicate the original exposure in dimension.
That's better.
Okay. We need an English major in this group. Okay. So, I lost where we were because we.
So, under windows for new transitional residential construction.
Okay. Should be consistent in appearance with those of historic residential buildings in the neighborhood. I think that's fine. For all construction materials, should be combined in historically appropriate combinations. Again, that's fine. Materials which are to be painted, such as previously painted facade materials and window frames, should be repainted in colors which complement the materials of surrounding historic buildings. We can talk about colors.
Color. Yeah, I thought we didn't. This paint can be changed. It's not permanent.
Right. So if somebody decides to paint their facade, do they have to come before the central business?
Well, if it's unpainted, previously unpainted, that's not allowed.
Yeah,
but if they're repainting,
But
such as previously painted facade materials and window frames should be repainted in colors which complement the materials of the surrounding historic building.
Yeah, I think that's good. That gives them guidelines. And then, you know, we really can't touch color.
But what if they want to pick a new color that's not historic?
Like an electric blue?
Yeah, I mean, that's I just think of some, you know, like you know, the woman that came in here, I can't remember, Ruth Feldman, is that what her name was, with the wellness practice that's right next to the Christian Science? And if, you know, if she didn't show us colors, but all of a sudden she decided to paint it like neon lime green or something, you know, and it just like stuck out like a sore thumb.
Yeah, it might be kind of funky.
I mean, actually, you know.
Well, but what it does say is that it's supposed to be, you know, similar historic colors. So that would, you know, knock out the lime green.
No, I know. And that's why I think we should leave it.
So we're really not making judgment about whether we like the color they've selected. We're only making judgment about whether it's a historic palette, really.
Right.
Why don't we just leave it, and if it comes to task, we'll deal with it.
Okay.
Sometimes historic colors, accurate historic color schemes can be pretty nasty.
You ever seen pictures of that, it's down in Connecticut, that historic Victorian, the vertical board and bat and siding, it's like a bright pink. It's a big famous museum house, but it blew me away. You'd see, it was literally a bright pink building. And that was the original color.
Like Pepto-Bismol pink.
like that pink. The first time I saw that, and then I realized it was historic. It just astounded me, you know. Typically people, they use white ink because it was the cheapest. You know, colors cost money. Mm-hmm.
The last point, is unpainted facade materials on historic masonry buildings should be painted only after careful consideration. And I guess I would say may, not should, but may be painted only after careful consideration. And I question, what is the careful consideration?
Yeah,
I would almost, I would say may not be painted. I don't have a problem with that. I don't think masonry materials should be painted if they're natural.
Sometimes it's done if you have two or three different types of masonry bricks, bad matching and all of that, that putting a coat of paint on is going to bring them into use. But again, I don't think any of the buildings downtown would traditionally have been painted masonry.
Mm-hmm. Maybe
that
if
would
you
be
said
a historic residential.
Have you ever seen, do you realize, you know, the Spoleto restaurant
that way
downtown?
A strong statement.
Every one of those bricks is painted,
but
and a slightly
not really
different tone.
Stating.
It was like,
if you carefully consider it, you can do it.
Did it in like a, you go look at it, it's like a yellow tan or brown. It's beautiful.
Faux finishing almost.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh. The Spoleto restaurant, they paint all that brick facade. And it's painted to look like a variegated, like slightly different toned
brick.
Like a yellow brownish brick. With, you know, it's
yeah.
Mild, not mild, but you know, there's slightly different tone changes in all the bricks. It
the
looks beautiful. It like looks like a new facade. That's just blown away.
Down the one on the other side, the now Spoleto's? Or
yeah,
the old
right
Spoleto?
Down in the corner by the trestle there.
Oh.
The old TJ's at? Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
When they did that, it just.
Little Jack August.
Yeah, no, that's actually burned down. That's gone.
That's where it was, though.
Yeah, that's where it was, man.
So
they
you
never
see.
Came before with a view, and they painted that. But
right.
In any case, fortunately, it was a nice exception.
Right. So, is it? Do we alter it slightly, or do we say it should not be painted? And.
Well, I'd rather just say not be painted, and if someone really, it comes to us with a good reason, we can certainly approve it.
Uh-huh,
that's true.
Just don't want to get someone who's going to clean up their building, right, before going to paint on it.
Mm-hmm.
Well, they do it without permission, it's too late anyway.
Does that seem reasonable to you?
Don't you agree? I mean, masonry materials shouldn't be painted.
Right. Mm-hmm. But and so there is paint that works with masonry, and it can in some ways extend the longevity of the brick. So
So you want to say should not be painted, like comma, with something like, with...
Well, I guess the only change...
With an exception to a board review or something like that.
I guess, to me, unpainted facade materials on historic masonry buildings may be painted only after careful consideration. I don't like should be.
Yeah, that stresses right. The importance of this. Yeah, that's good language.
So what's considered historic then?
The original buildings.
Yeah.
Mostly the historic theme buildings that are...
The ones that are masonry.
Yeah.
Theme buildings. So maybe painted only after careful consideration and approval or by the board?
Well, I think that is implied with the fact that these are the guidelines that they use when they come before the board.
Maybe painted only after careful consideration.
And review by the board.
And review by the board.
Is there anything in here about historic painted signs on the sides of buildings should be retained?
No.
There are a couple of them around town, I think.
Yeah.
And that's always something to be considered in preservation. You know, it's like the barns with the chew mail polish tobacco. You know, that's probably more significant than the barn itself, is the old advertising.
Well, so that was the last one we were going to go through tonight. So could I get, is there any further comment for this evening? Could I ask for a motion to adjourn?
A motion to adjourn the meeting.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.